Abovitz. He's a true engineering king. He earned his Bachelor of Science in Mechanical Engineering, as well as a Master of Science in Biomedical Engineering. What many of you may not know is that in addition to pursuing his academics, Rony was a member of the UN track and field team and was a cartoonist for the Miami Hurricane. As with many of our engineers, Rony was able to balance a lot of interests, pursuits, and passions. Following his graduation, Rony co-founded Mako Surgical, which was sold to Stryker in 2013 for almost $2 billion. Never one to rest on his laurels, Rony then founded Magic Leap, which in October 2014 received funding of over $500 million from Google and a group of investors in what has been described as the third largest venture capital deal in 2014. Tonight, we will hear from Rony and then provide our students with time for questions and answers. After that, we will have additional and more substantial refreshments. We encourage everyone to stay for some networking time with fellow engineers and entrepreneurs. So let's get started. Please join me in a warm King's welcome for one of our own, Rony Abovitz.
First, I just want to thank the dean and everyone involved in being able to invite me tonight. I remember my parents convincing me to come to UM to some degree when I was an undergrad. I turned down MIT, Northwestern, Michigan twice, once to go here as an undergrad, and then again in grad school. And looking back, I totally don't regret it at all. Now I have people from MIT and Northwestern Michigan all working. I did make it a little difficult for myself, but I'll kind of give you the story. So kind of the opener, I have I call it the spirit animal of my current company. And as an engineer, particularly if you're going to go start something, you have to almost mentally imagine you're going to be like swimming with sharks, which we have a lot of them here in South Florida. Oops.
See if it comes
test.
Out.
Test.
Yeah.
Answer.
More like a pop singer now.
Yes.
So I grew up scuba diving in South Florida, and the idea of swimming with sharks is always in my head. Mako was my previous company, and that was a shark. It was a fast one. But I thought, as an engineer, what is the right mindset? So you have to be in Orca. So when I was raising capital for Magic Leap, I would flash that. I wouldn't explain what it was, but it was like, I'm in Orca, and you guys are sharks. And we would speed on sharks. So there's a whole mystery of what Magic Leap does. I hope half the room isn't here to find that out, because I'm not really going to unveil it tonight. What I'm going to talk about is like being a Miami Hurricane out in the world. And I've sort of distilled it down to like six major moments, three which were key moments in Mako, three key moments in Magic Leap, and sort of one key moment in being a hurricane. Anyway, it was great. I loved being on campus. I loved being here. I sort of drank the whole university up. And I look back on a lot of things that I've done. I think I could attribute to things I learned here, either in class or hanging out with friends. Not in class, but just being around in the environment, I think, attributed to a lot of good things later. But one of the things I want to talk about, or something you don't really get taught, at least not when I was doing mechanical biomedical, like, what does it mean to be a leader? I think that's sort of important. It'll give you a mindset of what it takes to do some of the things I'm doing and trying to do still. And I think any engineer that wants to be an entrepreneur, it's not about making a lot of money. You have to want to lead forward an idea and have people follow you. And I just want to share with you like what I've learned on that. And then I'll talk about those six key moments, which I think are, they might scare the heck out of you, like I don't want to be an entrepreneur anymore, but they're sort of like truthful moments. So the good leader thing is not management. There's probably business school people here. So it's not like the MBA in management, which probably would have been helpful if I got one of those. But it's something else. Like, to me, leadership is like this esoteric quality that is more of a Zen state. Management is like the mechanical process of managing something or a business. But leadership is like an ineffable quality. So some of the ways I've been trying to dissect it for our team and hopefully pieces of this stick in your head if you want to go do stuff like I'm doing. You have to be very bold. Bold means you can't be timid. If you're going to do something, you just got to do it. You got to grab it. You like have to be unafraid. It's literally like jumping off a cliff with your backpack, a bag of parts. You're building the airplane wing and the engine as you're falling to the ground, and you only have like 60 seconds. Like, that's what it's like to be an entrepreneur. And if you're not bold, don't do it. But if you are bold, make sure you also have a plan that makes you can build the thing before you hit the ground. I think something you don't get told when you want to start a company, you're like, oh, I start a company, I'll be like Larry Page, I've got $40 billion. It's like, that's like one of those grace of God sort of stories. Most of the stories are you have to be insanely tough. Miami, you know, Dolphins 1972, undefeated, no-name defense tough. Like, you have to be willing to just get up off the ground, being pummeled over and over again, being told no about 250 times by investors, that your idea is the most stupid thing in the world, no one will ever use a robot in surgery, that's a dumbass idea, and you don't give up. So you have to have that, like, almost weeble wobble, probably half the group doesn't know what a weeble is, but you have to be able to get up off the ground, clean yourself up, and keep going. It's almost like maybe a defective brain state where you don't quit. But that toughness, if you're an engineer, toughness is one of the important material properties I learned. And I think I took home, like, you have to have that toughness. You have to have the resilience, that super elastic shape memory alloy. I actually can't ever be broken. You could be stretched, but you just won't break. And if you don't know what super elastic is, I would look that up. Freaking smart. And what I think is great about the university, the whole culture of bringing, like, you know, the best that would be going to MIT and Stanford come here. But if you're going to do this, you have to be, or believe you are, and will attract a team that are just freaking NASA, Caltech, SpaceX smart. Otherwise, why are you doing it? And smart doesn't mean snotty. It just means, like, you're in that place where all your brain power is going at it, and you just have this, like, NASA scientist 1960s Apollo attitude. Like, we're going to go to the moon. We don't even have real computers, but we're going to figure it out. It's sort of that kind of smart. I think the other part, I don't know if they teach this in the business school or not, but you need to want to win and win big. And we call this at our company the secretariat mode. Secretariat was like, I'm not just going to win. I'm going to, like, put accelerative distance. I'm going to surge, which is like the acceleration of acceleration on you. And you're just going, you're just moving so much faster. You have to have that mental attitude. It's not a desire to pummel your competition that's coming next. But you need to want it. Like, you know, don't get on the field if you don't want to win. Now, off the field, you can be a gentleman or a gentle lady. But on the field, you need to have that secretariat mentality, which is, I'm not even racing against other people. They're not even in the game anymore. You're just creating a new game, and you're just accelerating past them. The other part, and this is something engineers and probably business students don't focus enough on, is being creative and innovative. Like, go take art class, get somebody who is not thinking normally on your team. The people that have really made it are not thinking normally. They're like just a couple shades away from, like, you know, there's like a line where you're not okay, and there's a line where you're normal, and there's like an innovator and an entrepreneur. So you're riding that edge. You're just about there. But it means you figure stuff out. You're tying physics. You're challenging that. You're not challenging actual physics, but people's notions of physics are wrong. That's sort of creative innovation thing. And I've actually had that arm wrestling with physics a few times, and at least tied. You have to dream. Like, if you're not dreaming, you don't have, like, a vision, you're not thinking critically, and you're not, you know, if something isn't actually showing up in your mind, find that person on your team where it is. If you heard about the inception of Google, Larry Page has a dream, the entire internet just piling onto a bunch of computers. He literally dreamed all of Google in one night. I don't mean you have to literally have that dream, but it doesn't hurt. If you have one of those, like, definitely love to talk to you. But I think, like, you know, you're not told as an engineer or a business student that, like, these things matter, to be creative, to be innovative, to be out there, to dream, and to dream really big. Like, don't be limited by the dream. I think the leadership part, everyone's like, well, it would be cool to run a company, or, you know, like, The being the CEO is like this most miserable, hated job. You're everyone's slave. If you're doing it right, you know, you're there to serve everyone else. You're not there to be served. That's the kind of CEO people hate. The leadership means you're willing to go literally to the gates of hell and pull the damned out and have them follow you out into the light of day. It's like just that kind of, I'm going to do stuff for my team that they can't believe. It's really willing to go deep, and I think that's, you know, you're like, oh, I want to climb the ladder and be a senior VP of this and that. Like, the really great people I've met, that's not what they're like. It's a whole nother mentality. It's more of like this guy in Return of the King, you know, pulling the ghosts out and saving them. It's a whole nother mentality. Back to winning, like, make sure if you have an idea and a plan, it's going to do this to the market. It just got to be like, we talked about winning before, but you have to keep pulling back the mentality, like, do we have a strategy? Do we have a device? Do we have an idea that's going to just pummel everyone else? And is it just going to flatten the competition? And in that playground, that's you. But then this is also you. It's kind of like there's two yous. There's this and there's this. I'm not supposed to swear probably, but we literally do have a rule, and I've absorbed this rule from really great people who built some of the biggest companies in the world. The number one rule when you're hiring people is just don't be an asshole. And it sounds like very simple, but so many people forget that. The person, you shake their hand, you don't ignore them, you return that call, you do something kind to them. Even your competitors, who we just talked about pummeling, but then you pick them up, you give them a Gatorade. That's really important. Like, you know, this idea of gracious professionalism, like I judge for first, and it's like an important quality in, like, I think the next, you know, 50 years of what technology companies and companies can be. It's just the world can be a slightly different place, so you're not just about winning, it's about winning in a decent way. Something you're probably definitely not taught about in class is, what does it mean to rock? At Mako, we talked about this endlessly. We had Jimi Hendrix in every slide of our IPO roadshow, hiding away in plain sight of the bankers, they didn't see it. It means that, are you literally getting off on what you're doing? Or why are you doing it? You know, why did you go to school? Why are you alive, you know, doing something you hate? Go do the thing you love to do, and when you do the thing you love doing, you're gonna start rocking. It doesn't mean that you have to pick up a guitar. It could mean like material science, but find that resonant thing that you love, and you're gonna like wake up and not feel suppressed. And that's what you need to follow, and when you're not following the thing you love, you sort of become like lost and gray and anxious, and when you do find that place that's your happy point, all kinds of amazing things occur. And I haven't met a single person that's done something great that doesn't do this. Every one of them sort of overcame all those obstacles, and they finally found the thing that they love to do, and when they got there, it sort of all opened up. And it's really weird the way the universe will actually just start opening the doors when you're in that right place. And then you do that some more. And I think it's sort of like, don't ever lose that. I think that's superbly important, this idea of rocking. Like, literally, you know, put that in the back of your head. Is what I'm doing rocking? Am I going to rock customers? Am I rocking the world? Is it just going to be insanely awesome? We have a director of awesome in our company who goes around. That's not awesome. Why are we doing it? So the idea of being selfless is like the anathema of being an entrepreneur. You're like, entrepreneurs are like selfish, crazy, egotistical people. And what does it mean to be selfless? But the future companies we are building need to sort of give back. And as a leader, you need to give back. And you need to be that person that the 10-year-old version of you will not be embarrassed about. Always think back like you're 10, you have these heroes, you're like, am I doing something that 10-year-old version of myself would go, ugh, what are you doing? You're so gross. Or that's awesome, you guys are high-fiving each other. Like, never forget that, and sort of keep yourself from doing stupid, bad things. It's just, remember that 10-year-old self, unless that 10-year-old self is a really evil brat, you know, that's working together, I haven't done anything that is not based on a collective brain trust in a team that had to all contribute at the same time to even understand what it is we were doing. We took on big projects, big system projects like robotics and medicine, big complex projects now, which is like, you know, physics of light fields and interactions with your brain magically. Lots of complex things where multidisciplinary engineers and business people and marketing will have to get together and they have to cooperate. So when you're in school, that collaborative work, you know, right now you're probably just, you know, your grade, what you do on your own, but the quicker you sort of realize it's that plus you working in teams and being a selfless member of that team and moving the whole team forward, it's huge. It's not about backstabbing or crawling over the dead body of your teammate. It's really about, were you the selfless person that moved the project forward? That does get noticed. I think taking care of yourself is like the contradiction to you're gonna be up 24/7 eating ramen noodles and nonstop work. Both things are true. You have to figure out a way to run what I call like 100 Ironman in a row. Like if you don't wanna do that, literally don't start up a company. It's like not one Ironman, it's like 100 in a row. You're done, you just keep going. Like, oh my God, this is, you're running at like that 93%, you know, anaerobic efficiency rate where you're almost about to die, but you keep going for like a really long time. You gotta figure out what that is and like drink, you know, water and get healthy things and sleep at times and de-stress. All that's really important, and you need to sort of figure out how to tune yourself up because it's not a 100-meter sprint. It's a very, very long race, and if you're not mentally geared up for that, you can't make it. And then all the companies that have failed, you know, they just give up. They have bad ideas, and they give up, and they don't have the endurance. Like, I'll repeat a lot, the endurance and the mental toughness is superbly important. At the same time, I know this sounds horrible, but you're going to have a huge amount of fun if you're doing something. And when you're having fun, the team around you is having fun, you're enjoying life. Again, why are you doing this thing if it's not rocking, if it's not cool, if it's not what you love to do? You've got off the normal career path and you decided to build something amazing and cool for yourself and for the world. So have fun doing it. You know, when you're 90, you're gonna go, what did I do? So enjoy every second, and it's not only the goal, it's every single thing you do along the way should be fun and enjoyable. And then I'm going to move into the six moments. But I think the biggest thing is, like, don't take yourself too seriously. I gave a TED talk dressed up like an astronaut with some creatures on stage. And what I've been able to tell my team since then is, like, I'm not taking myself too seriously. You guys can't. And I think it's important because you start to get all heady. I'm this big, fancy tech entrepreneur. I have this wonderful idea. Then you become full of yourself. Your ego starts to fill up your brain. Your creative ideas go away. Always lighten up a little bit. Let your mind still be like a playful kid. And don't be too serious. Be really dead serious about your work, but don't be too serious about yourself. All right, so six moments that, like, in my, at least in my life from UM forward, were these like pivots, like pivotal moments in what it means to be an entrepreneur. I think there's a lot to be sort of learned on those. So on September 10th, 2001, I get a call. This was from my first company, and we're gonna get funded. We're gonna get like $15 million in funding. It's a great New York fund. We were like maybe 16, 17 people in the company. We were trying to do robotic surgery. It was like super exciting. I'm jumping up and down. My wife is jumping up and down. I get everyone together in the morning. It's like 8:45 in the morning. Everyone in the conference room, we're high-fiving. Get everyone together, and it's like 9 o'clock something, and then it's like this. Like someone comes yelling, and it's like, look what just happened. And we're like, wait a second, why are you watching TV? And you know, like my life went from we had a little bit of funding, and all of a sudden I have partners telling me on that morning of September 11th, they were gonna vote to give us $15 million in funding, and then I'm watching that. And the world is ending. You're like, holy cow. Everyone is freaked out. The world is basically ending. No one knew what to do. People were running around, and like the partners in our funds, some of them just barely escaped with their lives. One of them was supposed to get on one of the planes. It was like a horrific thing. I mean, it was a terrible, horrible thing for the whole country and the whole world. And then I'm all of a sudden thinking, back to my small little universe, what the heck am I going to do? Like, we're so unimportant in the scope of things. I guess everyone thought, well, we were done. We're just gonna close and go back, and our dream was over. The next day, I got up and like pulled the team back together and said, well, we're out of money, and our funding literally is gone. Everyone who wants to quit can quit. If you're not quitting, we're not stopping. And we're just gonna keep working, and we don't have any money, but we'll figure something out. And like one person left. So I have like a whole team of people, no one has salary, and we have no funding, and all of our investors think the world is ending, but only one person left. So what did I do? I got a van, we threw our prototype robot in it, and I started driving around the country and told the team, I'm not coming back, took two engineers, until we're funded. And we had one guy who was a board member, you know, Christopher Dewey, he was our white knight. He just kept the lights on. He gave us enough money to keep the lights on and was literally piloting me from Boston to New Jersey to the Midwest to Kentucky, anywhere and everywhere that anyone would even talk to us. And you think after SubhanAllah, who wants to hear about a company doing robot surgery? The world is ending. But I vowed to the team I wasn't going to stop until we figured something out. And several months later, we came back with a venture fund in Princeton and a major medtech company backing us, and like we survived. And I think, like, you know, that's not hopefully the norm you're gonna have to live with, but I went from like everything is awesome to oh my God, the world is ending. And then you gotta pick yourself up and go, what are you gonna do about it? And it was that story that got us funded more and more, because it was like these crazy guys that didn't quit after 9/11, they must have believed in what they were doing. And that was sort of this like mythology and character building thing for our whole group. It was like, there's something you're doing that you believe in enough to keep going. But it was like such a shock to my system, like, how is the universe doing this to me? And then it was like a really almost, you have this moment of being very selfish, like, what do you mean doing it to me? Look at all those people, they just lost their lives. But your dream is dead at that second too. So what do? We just kept going. And I think that's an important moment if you want to be an entrepreneur. Like, would you and your idea keep going in a moment of great tragedy? And will people still follow you in that sort of aftermath of just horribleness? And I think that's what happens. There are great moments and terrible moments, and you have to be able to keep going. So here was a great moment. So 2006, June, we had finally convinced the FDA to let a human-operated robotic surgery system be allowed to be used, cleared and safe and effective, which was like a complete thread the needle through the bureaucracy of the FDA. That was, there's a small miracle, probably an NDA to be taught about like how that happened. It was sort of a small miracle there. And that was the system we built. And that wonderful moment was, it was myself and four or five of our top engineers were here in a hospital in Fort Lauderdale with a guy named Dr. Roche. And they wheel this sweet woman in, she's probably in her late 60s, and she was gonna get our surgery. And she looks at us, oh, you must be the robot boys. She's like, don't worry, it'll be okay. And she's just looking at my head, and we're like, oh my God. This is happening. We had practiced on sawbones and cadavers. And then it was like, oh my God, this crazy, stupid idea that we suffered through 9/11 and everything else with is now about to do its first thing on an actual human being. And we had this rule at our company we called the grandmother rule and the mom rule. We never let something out unless you were ready to use it on your own mom. Because somebody's like, oh, the software is good. You probably turn in code for class or a paper, it's half good. Would you use that on your mom in surgery if it's wrong and you make it die? So we had that rule, and we stopped it many, many times. Probably for 7-8 months, I just kept going to the board going, no, we're not ready. People are screaming and throwing things at me like, what are you talking about? We're not ready. It doesn't pass the mom rule. Like, I have to stand in front of the freight train going, we're not ready. It doesn't pass the mom rule, because I knew there was a day where I'd be looking at someone's mom and grandmother. And I didn't care what the board said. I was caring more about that mom and grandmother. So that was a huge moment where all of us on the engineering side felt good that we stood up to our board, told our investors we were not going forward until we all felt 100% about it. We went to sleep with a good conscience. It was a great surgery. It was a wonderful outcome. And then the doctor, instead of following our flight plan, he decided to do like a world record minimally invasive incision. And I'm like, no, no, what are you doing? He's like, I'm doing it, and it worked. So that was kind of this moment of like, not only did we felt good about sticking up for what we believed in, we had designed every single thing, every line of code, every piece of hardware, we designed the implants from scratch. Every single thing going into that woman, we had done. And the leaders of that, of all those engineering teams were in the room with me. I dragged them, like, you're gonna watch this go down or it's gonna be successful. So you can't hide behind he did or she did it or this didn't work. Every line of code had to be good. Every single thing had to be right. That was one of those moments when it worked, we all felt like that was the greatest thing we ever did in our whole life. And we used to bring patients by all the time. They would come and visit us and you would see a patient with our device in them. And we had changed their life. You know, like a day later, they're walking around, they go to their kid's wedding. I meet people in the weirdest places. I met someone that's like, he like manages the Apple records for people. He had a makoplasty in his knee. I was like, oh my God, this is happening. So the idea, when you take care of your work, as in, particularly as an engineer, it's gonna reverberate through life and through the world in ways you never expect. And our mom rule, we ended up doing the mom of our head of software. We did relatives of top executives. We did sisters and brothers. I took my own grandfather to go to the doctor for it. So it really hit home at some point. So don't think you could just make something, throw it out there, and pollutes people or ruin something, and it won't come back. When you do the right thing, it comes back in a good way. So to me, that was one of those really key moments of when you stand up, you don't buckle in, but you build something really cool and great. It does pay off, and you can change lives. So now back to a depressing moment, but a positive moment. So what was supposed to be the most amazing, I had started coming thinking, you go public, that was like going to the Super Bowl. That was like you're high-fiving that 10-year-old self. Going IPO was like winning the Super Bowl. It's like this amazing thing, it's what you did. It's like winning it. I grew up playing video games, so that's sort of like the video game win. A few weeks before to go public, my father passed away. I'm just like in a mental state that I cannot function. And then I'm told we've got to go public now because the world is ending because there's a Great Depression coming if we don't go now. And I've got to get on a plane and go around for a month and this has to happen. So it's like, you know, I just had to like put my brain aside, get on there because like we have hundreds of people depending on me and a couple others and off we go. And we're doing this in the middle of the Great Depression. I'm like, how is this happening? I did the 9/11 thing. Come on, universe, this is not fair. Halfway through our IPO roadshow, we had Morgan Stanley, JP Morgan, the heads of the firms called us up. I remember being on a plane in the middle of the night in Chicago, snowstorm, and they say, it's over. We're pulling the plug. Just, you know, people are jumping off the ledges in Wall Street. Everything is crumbling. We're sorry, guys, you know, but we're pulling the plug. And we sit there, and we get back on the phone with them, and we basically say, F you. They're like, what do you mean, F you? We're like, no, we're not stopping. We're not quitting, and you can't do this, and we're gonna change the world, and who cares about your banking system? That's nothing to do with people's knees and hips and changing their lives. And we're yelling and screaming at the heads of these top banks. We're like, not our problem. Like an hour later, like, fine, you're back on. We go around, we're going around funds in Wall Street, going to London, going all around America. Nobody's there. Except for us. So the people managing like $1 trillion, like, what are you people doing here? Because like the world's ending. We're like, you, sir, are in your late 50s, and you probably have a sports injury, and this is what your life's gonna look like. And I would walk them through what would happen to their knee and hip if we didn't get funded and survive. And we made it. And we basically decoupled ourselves from all the stupidity going banking, and we had a great idea. And despite being in 9/11, and despite being in like the crash in 2008, going public in the crash, we still pulled it off. And you know, that just to show you, like, it doesn't always come easy, and you do have to stand up, and it doesn't always work that way. But that was one of those moments where, you know, my father died, the world's crashing, but I knew we had to make it. We had to sort of jump across that canyon, or everything the whole team was working toward would sort of go. And that was one of those moments where you look in the mirror and you're like, what are you built from? What are you made of, and what are you gonna do? So a happy moment. And this is sort of moving into Magic Leap a little bit. This was GoldenEye. So as Mako had succeeded and was sort of reaching its like just wheels turning, I started to get the itch to start a new company. And a friend who I was working with said, there's a guy named Christopher Blackwell he wants to meet, and he wants to talk about this idea you have. And he's in GoldenEye, which is like, you know, the James Bond thing. GoldenEye is like one of the, it's where Ian Fleming wrote all the Bond novels. And Chris Black will happen to be the guy who founded Island Records and signed bands like U2 and Bob Marley. He was sort of interested in this idea. So he says, come out to Goldeneye, let's spend a couple of days together. So I'm in Goldeneye, and that's where like the idea for Magic and Grid came. So I started to think, like, this is what computing was all about. I grew up with this. And computing is this thing that you look at. You know, it was like the Buddha that you grew up with. There's like a phone, a tablet, a PC. The whole engineering school is full of computers. And when I was in Goldeneye, I started to think, like, I don't want that anymore. Like, I love being out here just looking at this amazing place. The world is amazing. And I noticed some of the people that came with us, they had their phone in front of their face, and all they were doing is staring at their BlackBerry or iPhone or their Android phone. And they did not see the world there. So I realized computing had to change and it had to go inward. How do you bring people back into the world and still keep computing so that this thing isn't like the focus of your attention, but we're back in the world, we're back with people. And Goldeneye was that moment. It was going away from everything, being in this like swamp Caribbean jungle, away from all technology, where the sort of idea really fermented and came together. And I started to think, like, that's where the world becomes your desktop. It wasn't sitting in a lab, it was sitting in a lagoon, hanging out with very interesting people, like Jamaican fishermen, talking about, like, you know, Marley and going up into the hills looking for coffee beans. It was like a completely different vibe. And it was where ideas like this came about. Where do radical ideas come from? Sometimes you need to take yourself out of where you are into a different place. So for me and for what we're doing at Magic Leap, that was Goldeneye. And then it was like going to the grottos that Ian Fleming walked around in, where he wrote all the Bond novels, sitting at his desk looking out over the cliffs going, wow, that's pretty cool. If he could do that, I'll do a flying whale. So moment five, which to me was one of those, like, you know, golden eyes, like, okay, that's just a bunch of crazy ideas. But this is where my engineering degree came into play. We call this like Hello Gerald. Where, how do you do this? How do you actually bring ideas to bear? One of the great things I learned at UM, particularly being one of the first people in biomedical engineering, was there's biology and there's engineering. And the one thing I took away that was top of my list was biology wins. We've been around for a long time. Why are we gonna change our biology? We need to make technology adapt to people. People are first, people are in the center. Don't settle for crappy technology. The whole history of early medical devices was like subjecting people to all these horrid contraptions, and you just have to put up with it. And I walked away from graduating here with the idea that no, that was not the right thing. How do we make people first? And not just medical devices, every single thing we do with technology, how does it force itself to be accommodating to us as people, our lives, our social situations, the way we are? We should not bend to technology, technology should bend to us. And in doing that, we realized part of computing, the amazing thing about computing is that it has immense power, it has immense capability. But we have an amazing computer already, head-mounted. It's called our head. And inside it is the, you know, most amazing computer we have, which is our brain. And the question we asked at Magic Leap was, how do I make the brain do stuff? How do we get in there and tap into it? How do we use its capabilities? So imagine that you have a computer where you have a core processor, but you don't have a display. And the part of your brain that makes the world is your new display. And the first time we did that, we called this guy Gerald. We're like, that was kind of amazing. And for me, that was an epiphany moment where we tied physics. We tied physics, we tied biology. There's nothing you can actually learn about what we're doing from the picture of Gerald. But it was a moment where you have an idea, but it's not the idea. It's the actual manifestation. It's the sweat and fight. And we have a bunch of Caltech and all kinds of folks in the company arguing this wasn't possible, and this can't happen, and you can't make light solid because light's not solid, and blah, 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 blah. And you're like, okay, what's going on there? And then you realize there's biology at play. Biology in the brain is a whole nother ballgame. It's not just the physics of the outside. It's the physics of the inside of the brain. And what we are exploring, and I think it's a whole area for the next 100 years, is understanding the physics and biology of the brain and our outside world of technology and how those things interact. I think that's gonna be amazing, you know, decades and decades to mine and understand them. We're like at the pong level. We're at the, you know, like super low bit level of understanding what that means. But I think it's a super exciting place. And just a couple things on that. So this led to the idea of how do you make technology feel more magic, which is how do you make technology disappear? As engineers, we're like, look at the thing I built. As people, you're like, it's not the gadget, it's what you do with it. It's how you make, how it makes you feel. Those things are incredibly important. So to me as an entrepreneur, you have to ask the question, why would I want this? How is it making my life a lot better? How is it making someone else's life a lot better? And is it causing me to deviate from being a human being? Or is it like letting me sort of explore things that I love as a human being? Is it letting me do awesome things? You know, one of the motivations I had was, how do you make really awesome things come to life? I was like overly influenced by movies probably growing up. Star Wars, I wanted to build droids, so I built droids. I figured droids that shoot stuff bad, medical droids good, go become a biomedical engineer, build medical droids. But you know, like Harry Potter, cool, love to do that, gonna actually make that happen. You know, so movies influence what we do as engineers. Rod Brooks, who was one of the geniuses of AI, what is he doing that for? Because he saw HAL in 2001. And I asked him, he was one of our advisors, why are you building HAL? HAL was cool in the movie, but do we need to build HAL? I asked my friends at Google, those robots that are dogs? No, bad idea. They're gonna do this. And you know, that's fun in a game where you can sort of like play with them and they're actually not made out of real physical things. They're made out of photons, not atoms. But maybe AI robots that can run around and do things independently of us, we need to think about that. We have to put ethics into that. We have to put Asimov's laws into that. We're actually at the age right now where machine vision is at a renaissance. Computing power is reaching very scary levels. I've seen some really intense things run AI. The responsibility of everyone in the room who is an engineer who's going to start things is it's going to be unavoidable. You're going to face this. You're going to face AI and this sort of, whether it's called machine intelligence or search, it's all the same thing. It's machines waking up. And is it helping us as people, or are we going to change the world with it and do something good or not good? I think the ethical decision is really important as an engineer. And then for sort of the business students, the oh my God moment, which I'd like to, I wish I had a really good explanation. This is the best explanation I have for sort of where Magic Leap got to be. So we're a company in South Florida, which no one cares about, nobody wants to fund. But now maybe they will a little bit. One of the hopes I had for coming out here is how do we create that ecosystem in Florida, hopefully around the university, so maybe this could become like a Stanford of the South or something. So a couple of cool things. So just a few months ago in October, we raised some pretty serious capital, which I still like wake up all night going, holy crap. I can't quite describe it. There is no recipe. I wish I could like, then you need to do this. Everyone like just gets up and leaves. So I'll tell you a little bit of the story because it's part universe and part will and part just things that should be, I guess. A couple of days later, a guy named Alan Eustace takes a Magic Leap, right? So that's Alan. That's just a few days later after we close our funding. So that's October 24th, Alan jumps out of outer space, basically. And a few days before that, we raise a significant amount of capital. And that's Alan jumping from outer space. So basically, he breaks Felix Baumgartner's world record, the guy Red Bull sponsored. And I think it was 135,000 feet. Alan wakes up in the morning, he's an engineer, goes up in a balloon, decides to jump off that balloon, breaks Mach in his homemade spacesuit, and becomes like a Chuck Yeager figure. So this is important for a couple of reasons. One, it was freaking cool that Alan did this and he's an engineer. But the cooler part was a few months earlier, Alan visited Magic Leap. He's why we got funded. So Alan was like one of the top engineering guys at Google. And he happened to be hanging out in Cape Canaveral, just not too far away from us, and calls me up and says, what's your GPS coordinates? I give him the GPS coordinates of the company. And GPS coordinates. He's like, I'm flying, I'm doing something, I'm about to jump. but I'll see you in the court. He was practicing for this jump. He lands, he spends the day with us. It was awesome. And I had no idea, and no one had any idea, that the Alan that visited us, this quiet, nibbishy, late 50s engineering professor guy, who's kind of a genius, is that guy. And that guy made this happen. So it's like he's an engineer, but he had all the qualities I had talked about. He was bold, he was a genius, he was an innovator, he didn't ask for any money. He did this in the garage, really quietly. And just like everything I love about engineering and innovation and being daring, and he's quiet and honest all at the same time. And he came by to us and apparently sent some epic email to Larry and Sergey and everybody, said like, whatever they're doing is insanely awesome. And I'm like, whatever you're doing is insanely awesome. So it's kind of this like party of the insanely awesome. So one last cool bit, and like, again, there's no business school recipe for how to do stuff, but before that, I sort of intersected. This was my getting out of my comfort zone. I reached out to a group in New Zealand on the other side of the earth from us. Different time zone, southern hemisphere, not far from the South Pole. And there's a guy named Richard Taylor, and he starts his company with Peter Jackson. And they convince some people to give them $200 million, and they make this movie called The Lord of the Rings, and then they bring James Cameron down there, and they make Avatar, and they make The Hobbit. And I was enamored, why on earth was this happening in this little tiny island, the speck of the earth, on the other side of everything? How they pull it off. So I went to visit them, I befriended Richard, and he incubated Magic Leap there. He actually, I worked with them from like 9 o'clock at night till 2 in the morning, and then I did robot stuff for the day and have discussions with Richard at night, and his team is waking up, and we're just doing this round the clock thing to find, my wife says, you need to solve this. And we ended up with this idea. It was an interesting idea. The company was birthed out of a creative process. And that creative process was sort of a vision, which I woke up with a dream of a guy jumping from space. I called it taking a magic leap. And in 2009, the Weta team was sketching this out. And sort of that discussion led to a whole bunch of technology development, which led to building something really cool and real. And what was interesting is that we sketched out everything Alan had done just about a few years earlier. So I kind of think it was like time travel is possible. That's the next company. But the cool part, and I'll just hit this one last time, I think when you're doing something neat and you're doing it with neat people and there's that convergence, like something amazing is going to happen. So the kind of people that will believe in big change the world ideas are the kind of people that will jump from space, design it on their own, and do it. So are you the kind of person that'll wake up in the morning and want to, you know, go 130,000 feet and jump? Or do you want to work with those kind of people? I think that's that desire and pull. If you really want to change the world, you have to do, you don't have to, don't go jump. I'm not saying please, don't do that. But it's sort of the mental attitude. And kind of the last thing, and then I know we'll be questions, more about dreams are good and not quitting, and it's sort of my UM story. I have a bunch of UM stories where I'm getting in trouble a lot, so I'm not gonna go there. But I did have a dream when I was a freshman of playing football, playing baseball. That was so not to be. Walk out there, everyone's like really big, and I'm like very small next to the coach. Like, you could be like the fifth string tackling dummy, and just basically never travel, and you'll probably nearly die after 60 days, but if you wanna do that. So I'm dejected, but I wake up having a dream about throwing a javelin. Like, I've never even thought about that. So as a freshman, I walk out to the field over there, go over to the coach and say, I had a dream about throwing a javelin. Can I join the team? And he's like, get the hell off my field. And that was kind of the rude awakening of, that's not how you get on the UM track and field team. So like an entire year, I'm just like insanely obsessed about making. So I get a javelin, and I'm working out, I'm doing all this kind of crazy stuff. I come back the next year, coach is like, what are you doing? And I'm like, I really want to throw javelin for UM. He's like, you go back to engineering class, what are you doing here? And then he's like, all right, if I don't kill you this afternoon, and you don't quit, and you don't die, you'll make the team. And he made everybody just stop and he just sort of ran me around till I puked over and over again. And I'm crawling on the ground, like, are you gonna quit? And I'm like, no. And he just kept doing that, fine. He's like, fine, I think you're gonna die, but I'll let you in. So I was like the worst, like, mistreated person in my sophomore year. Finally, the junior, they actually let me really be on the team, and then it was great. But sometimes when you really want something, I think I learned how to be an entrepreneur by doing something that I shouldn't be doing. I was like an honors engineering student, like scholarship, you know, that's what I was supposed to be doing. I'm like, what are you doing hanging out with the athletes? So I was like the last person on the team, and I was like, I want to be able to make that team because maybe I can get a girlfriend, and it worked. But that not giving up, I think, was incredibly important. And it was so hard to do something that you're not natively good at. I wasn't like a gifted athlete. I was like the not a gifted athlete. But I think that hard work is, if there's a theme in what it means to start something, you have to have a really great idea. You have to be smart. You have to be determined. You have to be selfless. But you have to like never, ever, 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 ever give up. I think that's the key. So thank you very much.
Wow, what an incredible speech. Thank you. Let's give another round of applause for Sam. Okay, so thank you for the lecture. And I know there are several people out there with questions, so I'm going to take a little page out of President Shalala's book and allow only students to ask questions tonight. So I believe there are microphones throughout. If you have a question, go ahead and raise your hand. Perfect. So if you didn't hear that, if you do have a question, please head to the back of the room. They have microphones for you. You can go ahead and ask a question.
Hi, this is everyone. Thanks tonight. My question is, so I read that you hired Neil Stephenson as a chief futurist.
Yes.
I'm a fan. Just wanted to know if you could tell the story of how you met him and convinced him to join the team.
So, very quick story with Neil. We actually sent a contingent to his home in Seattle. We sent Richard Taylor, our head of games, a guy named Graham Devine, who's sort of a big figure in games and computing, and a couple other folks. And we brought Neil. I read that Neil was a big fanatic of swords. So the sword Orcrist, which was used in The Hobbit, we got it. I had begged Richard to actually get Orcrist, and we came to Neil's door with Orcrist, and a note that said, "We bring you, O great Neil Orcrist. Will you become our chief futurist?" We literally did that. And he was like, "You people are insane, but yes." And it was kind of awesome. And literally, that is what we did. We did something spectacularly cool for him, and he said, "Anyone that's going to do that, I think I need to join this band." So we made a dramatic gesture. And he's pretty freaking cool. Like, it's hard to believe that I fill out expense reports and say, "Neil Stephenson." It's a bit hard to grasp your mind around that.
Hi, my name's Hunter. I actually have a biomedical product I'm submitting to the business plan. But I have diabetic, actually, and I see either making, you know, the organs and everything else and diabetic and stuff like that. And obviously, with all the work that you've done, I feel you're the best person to comment on this. Where do you see the intersection of, you know, life and technology going in the next 10 years, and like what to watch out for? Just comments.
I think the whole field of computing is the intersect going forward is life and technology. I think it's probably where this area can make its mark. So I'd say you're in like probably the best possible field you can be. I think the idea of just making an app like another WhatsApp or something is becoming slightly old. So I'd say that we know very little about the biology. We know a lot more about technology. I'd say the number one thing is like really understand the biology of what you're trying to solve in ways that not only are the biological parts, but the process parts, the chemical parts, the physics of it. We work with physicists to understand biological processes, computational modeling. Like everything you can think of, non-traditional engineering field you can bring in would be huge. But I completely agree the next decade is like the decade of like sort of life and technology coming together in a huge way. And not just in medical devices, in like every single thing we do.
Thanks for the awesome talk, Sam. Well, you pointed out some qualities that you, of course, have. But how much of these things actually you acquire on the go, or how much do you have at the beginning?
So I don't actually believe I have them. I think that you're always falling short. I think you're like trying to, you know, over-aim and you're pushing for them. I don't think you have all of them at the beginning. I think you have to want to have some of them. And I think you have to have like a good intention. And I think that's really important. You have to have like, you know, are you a Jedi or a Sith? I know that sounds kind of odd, but we literally, when I interview people, like we try to sift Siths away and send them to Microsoft or something. So I'm for Microsoft. And you have to have that intuitive, you have like a noble purpose. That's the core. You know, are you actually trying to do something positive? And then I think push in that direction. I always think everyone in my team and myself, we're always falling short of those things. But we're always, our vector is pointing there. I think make sure your vector is pointed north. I think that's really key. And you never get there. There's no there to get to. It's that you're pointing north. I don't know if that makes sense.
Hi, my name is Anna. And then you mentioned earlier that you should aspire to be someone that your 10-year-old self would want to high five and think they're awesome. What did you want to be when you were 10 years old?
That's a very tough question. I think I wanted to be an X-Wing fighter pilot and have a lightsaber. That was, and play for the Miami Dolphins, and do something really cool with science and engineering. I had all those things at the same time, and I was like, I'm not going to be an X-Wing fighter pilot. I'm not going to play for the Dolphins. This science and engineering thing might work. And what's really weird is that has led me to all the other stuff, like intersecting with people that do X-Wings and all the other cool things. But probably at the heart of it, you know, the really honest answer is like I was a science fair geek, so probably that's really what I was doing already.
Hello, I'm Mary Wilton. I have a question. Well, I also wanted to be a Jedi, by the way, so that's pretty cool. Earlier you were talking about how all your colleagues were looking at their phones and all that stuff and they weren't acceptable around them when you went to that island, like kind of forgot the name. But do you believe that like technology that kind of takes over all your inputs, like sensors, like for example, Oculus Rift, like all those virtual reality things that kind of just cloud out everything going on around you, do you think that's the opposite way of how technology should be going? Or is that acceptable?
I think it's a really bad idea. Yeah, I think our sensory inputs are, this is the study of biology a little bit, are tuned to intake the world that we live in. We sort of evolved to be in the physics of this world, and we really want to respect those inputs and why they're there. And anything you add to that needs to be really well tuned to our neurobiology and our sort of psychology. I think just shutting it all out and, you know, really bluntly with like a blunt instrument is a potentially really bad idea.
Okay, so I think we have time for two more questions or one more. All right, one more question, yes, sir.
Hello. It said on the program that you graduated with your master's in 96, and the first thing that you brought up was in 2001. I was wondering what kind of work experience and what did you do before you founded your company?
So basically, I had this period of grad school and starting my company where I had started the company not realizing I needed to make an incorporation. So in 96, actually almost the year before I graduated, I started a think tank company that we called ZCAT, where we incubated all the ideas that became Mako. So I was actually still hanging out on campus. My girlfriend then wife was a director of student activities, and we were just sort of hanging around, and I was like this like weird kind of almost like postdoc, kicking, you know, get off campus already, and, you know, living in a grad apartment, and like using that period of time to sort of incubate in Woodshed. I was doing consulting work. I was thinking I'm going to go back to school, do a PhD, and then I started a company in 97. And that was a research think tank company. And then in 2001, decided to make it a real company. And that was kind of, that woodshedding was incredibly important. It was like post-grad school, pre-really getting very serious about what it was. But I used that time to explore robotics, computer-assisted surgery, went around the country, visited professors at Northwestern and MIT and Caltech, got a lot of really good insight, made some good friends, and built the relationships to actually start something for real. So that woodshedding, I would never trade that. It was really important.
All right. That is actually all the time we have for questions today. But the night isn't over yet. On behalf of the students, we have something, just a little token of our appreciation, and it's coming. Okay, just another hat to add to your collection. So hopefully next time you're thinking of your $1 million idea, you'll be wearing this and remember us. And I believe the dean also has something he would like to present to you.
Well, awesome presentation. Again, thank you very much. So we had to dig to find something to give you that's meaningful to you. And if you recognize this, is it up there or?
No, that's not.
It's not. Oh, not yet. Okay. But do you remember when we started? We said that he was a cartoonist for Miami Hurricanes.
Yeah.
So we finally found something that he did, and it will be shown to you in a second. That's technology. It's still slow. So we wanted to know exactly what made you do this cartoon.
Do you remember that?
Sir.
89, yeah. Yeah, I think that was getting turned down on
the day. Oh!
I think that was asking out a girl that didn't go so well. Yeah, cartooning was not the same thing as being on a football team.
We're almost there. Well, anyway, I really appreciate you taking the time to come out here. And it really wasn't that far from where you are, right? So please keep visiting us. And I think all the students would appreciate you sharing with them. In fact, if we come to you, get some consulting, I think, is what's going to go on. Thank you again. Thank you very much.
Okay. And now, to sort of conclude this part of the program, I'd like to invite you all, fellow students, alumni, and other professionals, to enjoy your time networking in the living room area where we started the beginning of the night. There's still a lot to talk about, and I encourage you all to continue this conversation. We have additional refreshments for your enjoyment while you network, and I believe that you'll be staying with us a little longer. So thank you all for coming. Have a wonderful evening.